Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. This is Chrism, and I'd like to welcome you to this conversation about your Kundalini Awakening experience. But before I do, I would like to introduce Her Holiness, the Celtic Queen of Questionable Comforts, Amelia Suntara.
The Celtic Queen of Questionable Comforts. Okay.
Yes.
Hello, everybody. It's really good to be here. Thank you, Chrism, for that introduction. If I can begin, I would like to say it's really good to be here. I enjoy my Wednesdays. I enjoy coming here on a Wednesday and being with you all and listening to Chrism's teachings. And, you know, at this stage now, we have a few people after logging into our chat room, and all the names are becoming so familiar. It's like a gathering every week in the chat room of people. Mike says, here we go, as the program begins. So, hello, Sukha. It's nice to see you again. And Mike and Lorna and Fashchi, and there's one or two others there as well. So, Chrism, I would like to give the address of where people can go if they would like to make a donation. The donations that are received go to support the work that Chrism does in all the places where Kundalini Awakening systems are. So that would be on the websites, on Facebook, here on YouTube, where he has a lot of videos with Kundalini teachings. Chrism doesn't, this is his full-time work, and so all donations are greatly received because, like us all, he also has bills to pay, phone bills, internet bills, petrol, car, all these sort of things that we all have to pay as well. So all donations that support him in doing the work that he is doing are greatly appreciated. So I'll tell you the address you can go to now. It's www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. That's www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. And as I say, up in the right-hand corner, you'll see that donate button, and it's very easy to donate after that. Now, please, nobody is to feel any pressure to donate. I do this every week so that people are aware that donations are very, very gratefully received, and they are very, very helpful. But there is no pressure on anybody to donate. It's just if you are in a position to do so, if you would like to do so, well, this is where you can go to make your donation. So, Chrism, I'm really looking forward to the show today. And if anybody wants to phone in, the number is USA 347-934-0026. And I'd be delighted to say hello to you and put you through to Chrism if you would like to speak with him on the show about any aspect of the Kundalini Awakening or any question. Okay, Chrism, that's me done for a while.
Wow, it's so nice to hear you.
Well, thank you.
You have such a smooth professional sound too, Amelia. It's like you've been doing this for years.
Well, I actually have, you know. We've been doing it since 2012. So that's how many years now? We're heading for 2 years. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, your development along this whole talk show thing has been really great. I mean, you come out very smooth, very professional, very commercial. I think you should go get your radio announcer's license.
Is there such a thing there?
Yeah, Channel 1. Channel 1 in Ireland, right?
Okay. We'll do that then.
All right.
I'm looking forward to seeing the topic for today, Chris, when you announce it. I go blue now.
All right. So as everybody, well, I'm not sure everybody knows this, but just in case somebody doesn't, there's never a real script for me when I do these programs. It's stream of consciousness. It's pretty much getting into a click that the Kundalini wants you to kind of get into and then opening to verbalize what it is saying. And this also involves opening up certain channels of access. a blending that I'm currently having a difficult time finding a way to describe for you. But these access points are used by the Kundalini as a way of allowing strong energies to flow into a system that has been upgraded, but still needs to be grounded in this earth, you know, very strongly in order to take that energy and therefore that teaching, you know, into the general populations. So that's kind of where I'm at with this. When you get the feeling of what it is to surrender to your Kundalini, when you get the feeling of what it is to participate in the Kundalini activation or awakening that you're experiencing, you know, that makes a big difference. That's really, when you're not fighting it or struggling to figure out what it is, when you finally reached a certain point where you can identify, you can say, oh, that's my Kundalini. That's my Kundalini coming through here. That's my Kundalini communicating with me through a specific symptom. That's my Kundalini communicating to me through a certain symptom, whether it's a kriya or entities or, you know, seeing, you know, high teachers coming to you, being taken by angelic type of consciousness. You know, many of these features, you know, accompany the Kundalini, but part of the deal is undergoing the transformation. So when I open to that channel within me, when it that wants me to talk about these things, when I open to the Kundalini, I'm getting energy. I'm receiving energy. I'm receiving the download. I'm receiving the actual communication from my Kundalini speaking to you, you know, over this technology. And it does carry Shaktipat with it. You need to know this. If you don't want Shaktipat, stop listening right now. Especially now, it's Blue Day, you know, and I'm right in the middle of a Shaktipat. So be advised. As you open to these areas, as I mentioned before, as you give in for the first time, and for the first time you realize that it's not so much giving in, but it's no longer resisting a certain aspect of the Kundalini symptom. As you realize, like, oh, that's the Kundalini, and oh, the symptom means the Kundalini's, you know, wanting me to arch my feet severely, or to pull all the toes up severely, or to have my nostrils flare amazingly wide. And, you know, and the many, many, many other associated phenomena with Kundalini awakening or activation. When you're able to begin to identify repeated phenomena upon yourself, your comfort level will grow with what the phenomena is bringing to you. Oh, let's see. I got to ask everybody. Tim, hello. Nice to see you there. Tim Ashford, Suka, Mike, Lauren, Fasci, and Julie. Good to see you. Good to see you all. Thank you for coming. Is the sound coming through okay, or am I talking like an idiot? Or am I talking like an idiot, but the sound's fine? Fasci. Fasci. You're signing up for that one, eh, Fasci? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, very good. Very good. I will continue. So when you open to this channel and you begin to experience experience more phenomena and you begin to experience patterns of recognizable phenomena associated as you're beginning to learn with the Kundalini, you know, tingles up the spine or seeing floating lights or seeing what could be called ghosts, you know, really having a lot of different psychic phenomena, sometimes at the same time. You begin to piece together that, you know, something's, you know, quite different there in the old body program. And it can cause you fear. But as you, even though some of you will have terrifying experiences because the fear that's caused in you will drive you to run. And when you run from what is causing fear, it gives that which is causing the fear a greater creative expansion. So now instead of being chased across an open field where you could turn around and say, hey, WTF, right? Why are you chasing me? Now all of a sudden you're in a subterranean ruin and you don't know which tunnel to go down. And so they've been able to really intensify points of anxiety for you. And they use the anxiety to control you. And the they that I'm talking about are the negative influences that want you to be corrupted, that strive actively for your corruption, actively, all the time. You have to remember, when you're not in a body, you don't suffer the ravages of time. You've got all the time there is. You can stick to that person from birth till death, and it'll be a bat of an eye of a gnat's eyelid. Okay, so not easy being in a human being flesh, limited awareness body. You know, there's a lot of opportunity for corruption. But there's also certain governances, shall we say, in place that allow for you who have come so far because you've heard of the word Kundalini, you're actively learning about the word Kundalini, and therefore you're receiving an invitation from the Kundalini itself within you through harmonizing with that Sanskrit name. So it's important for you to understand that there's this huge level of activity that's occurring as you receive more energy, as you open to that conduit, as I was describing earlier. And you have levels of information that are both tactile and mental and emotional are dealing with specific issues that are being pulled, not surprisingly, and orchestrated, not surprisingly, by the Kundalini in me. It's like I was telling Her Holiness, Amelia Suntara. It's like I was telling her right before the show, well, I hope the show's going to be good. So anyway, one of the things that I would like to start out this show with, or at least this part of the show, is a reading from the Radiance Sutras. And here we go with that reading. All around you, in every moment, the world is offering a feast for your senses. Songs are playing, tasty food is on the table, fragrances are in the air, colors fill the eyes with light. You who long for union, attend this banquet with loving focus. The outer and the inner worlds open to each other. Oneness of vision, oneness of heart. Right here, in the midst of it all, mount that elation. Ascend with it. Become identical with the ecstatic essence embracing both worlds, wherever, whenever you feel carried away, rejoicing is in every breath. There. There is your meditation hall. Cherish these times of absorption. And so there you have a reading from the Radiant Sutras. Feel free to call in or write in on the chat group if you have any kind of a comment on that and what it means to you and how your kundalini is forming a response to it, a feeling or a level of bliss that might be coming over you at this moment, tears coming to your eyes. All classic symptoms of kundalini absorption, but also kundalini infatuation with some of the early controls of the blissful enlightenment response. For most people, it's not just sudden wham, and everything is ascended and enlightened, and you know they can fly off to the next journey, that whatever that may be for them. For most of us, it's a journey, and the journey is consistent and constant and yet ever changing. And we learn and we apply those new learnings to the new educational equations that the Kundalini is offering for us. And these are constantly driving us toward the level of divine acceptance amidst divine transformation. Think about that. Okay. You're being changed. Many of you are being changed just by listening to this conversation. What I'm suggesting to you now is to recognize that change in you now. Don't be afraid of the changes that the Kundalini is bringing to you. Whether you were seeking it or not doesn't really matter. It's here now. That is what matters. Get used to it. There's no need to turn you into some MD's idea of a science experiment. Okay? All MDs are not that way. But too many of them are more chemical doctors than medical doctors. And I would just as soon have you steer clear of the chem docs as opposed to those wonderful, beautiful medical practitioners who are honest and have high degrees of grace. They just don't know what it is. But they're there to help you. Those are the ones you want to stay with. Those are the ones that will offer you information when you ask for it, that will stop a treatment when you tell them to, you know, that type of thing, that type of MD, that type of person. Not always easy to find, I must admit, but they're out there. I have found them. They're out there. Okay. So as these new energies come in and you begin to have these new phenomena, and you will have them, I got to tell you. You know, if you have so much expectation, it's like, oh, God, I just want to have cranial migration. I just have to have cranial migration. If you want to have it so much, you're going to block it by your expectation and your need to have it. Too much of your energy and your expectation is going to block that reception. So you just lightly, gently focus on it and put in some of that Huna power prayer. And which I have covered in other conversations, the Huna power prayer is very effective. And if it's something that you truly want, you will get it. You will get it. But you're always going to receive it based upon what your kundalini wants you to receive. Not so much what your ego wants to receive. You may be surprised. Certainly your ego could be surprised to hear that. It's not so much about what the ego wants, but it's very much about what the Kundalini and its agenda with you. So understand that. So you will get phenomena. I don't, you know, whether it's light, small phenomena, but it's going to be phenomena, and it will typically be phenomena that's far away from what your expectations were. Now, sometimes it will come within the expected parameters, but you know, sometimes that's just the way the person set it up by having that fear or having that issue that allows the experience to be used as a trigger point for Kundalini activity. So expect the phenomena, but don't be blown away by it. I mean, enjoy. It's really cool stuff. It's really cool stuff. Opening to that channel that I was talking about earlier, there's always a level of bliss with that. It feels tremendously good. Almost too good. You don't want to come back. You don't want to leave. You don't want to make that separation, even though with Kundalini, the separation is very thin. Very thin. Think about this for those of you who are searching and exploring about the Kundalini. Think about this. Having is very, very, very different from wanting. And you know, I think this is coming up because of I get a little frustrated with some of the people that are taking the Shakti pot that we're in the middle of right now. You know, every day at 3 a.m., you know, I'm giving, a few people Shakti pot, one chakra at a time, for 7 days. And it's the typical a quarterly Shakti pot that I give, and I invite all of you to attend it if you wish. Yeah, you can go to Facebook, Kundalini Awakening! ! Or Yahoo, Kundalini Awakening Systems 1 at Yahoo Groups. You can get on there if you're interested in participating in that activity. So I give the Shakti pot to people, you know, and I put together, I think, a fairly good system for people developing and receiving Kundalini activation and awakening within a equation that will preserve their sanity and ensure degrees of safety as they begin to walk an enlightened path. It's not the easiest path to walk. Go ahead. Try stepping on a sunbeam. You can step into it, but can you step on it? Can you let the sun ride you as you try to ride it? There's so much to say, but the scenario is basically the same. You're going to have phenomena as you begin to awaken into larger, expanded consciousness areas. This phenomena isn't always gentle. It's going to rock you. It's going to shake you. It's going to change the way your body does its thing, but, you know, with you. You'll gain a mannerism or you'll have a real strong desire to do a certain type of stretch or a certain type of yoga position or Pilates position or a certain way of twisting the spine. Maybe you'll feel like your spine's become a snake or has that kind of limberness. That's what happened to me early on. It's kind of weird. So as this phenomena proceeds within you and you're experiencing the changes and you're going through this, the last thing I want you to do, especially for those of you taking the Shakti pot, is to try to find ways around the phenomena. I don't want you to exert any controls over your Kundalini awakening experience or the reception of those energies within the Shaktipat. You don't get to control that. Your ego doesn't get to control that. The only thing that gets to control that is Kundalini itself. That's how it works. It's a viable consciousness, self-aware, on its own. And it will determine what levels of refinement teachings you need to experience in order to bring you into a greater expression with the Kundalini. Don't get in the way of the phenomena that's coming because it scares you. You, most of you, have come into this knowing the word Kundalini, knowing, to greater or lesser degree, what that entails, what that involves, what that's about. Most of you have that experience, not everyone. But this show seems to be dedicated towards some general highlights of other shows that I've done with regards to responding to stronger levels of enlightenment upon the physical or the five purushas or five sets of identity that comprise the human expression. You're going to get issues associated with each set. Each single Purusha is going to have a level of interaction and learning and moving into and around and through. You might want to read Sri, and I believe that's spelled S-R-I, Aurobindo, capital A-U-R-O-B-I-N-D-O, Aurobindo. And just Google Aurobindo, Bingo, and Purusha, Purusha, and see what he says about it. Because his experience is very similar to my experience. But it, you know, it flies in the face of the ultra-conservative, beautiful people, the ultra-conservative Sanatana believers, which, you know, they have a very, strict interpretation of some of the ancient Hindu texts. They like to get into this Purusha business. At least that's what I've found. But as you have these experiences and as you begin to manifest phenomena upon your system, as that phenomena begins to surprise you in its severity, don't get in the way of the phenomena just because, you know, it's actually there. What are you doing here? I want you to have the phenomena. Some of it's going to be irritating, maybe, sure. You know, you get the tinglies in the feet, you know, and it doesn't stop for a while. That can be a little irritating. Or you're having orgasms during business meetings, mostly for the women. And that, you know, that can be a little off-putting, I guess, certainly. So, and it's not all going to go according to what your consciousness, your higher or lower consciousness would want to have occur. But it's there, it's coming, it's not going to stop. It is you that has to learn to become friends with your Kundalini. You have to learn to be friendly with your Kundalini, to honor your Kundalini as a divine particulate of God that is here to help your change and your emergence into the more dense levels of the divine reality. Dense means, you know, you're kind of at the bottom of the ladder there. But you're there. You're there. You made it. You've come a long way to have the Kundalini. Many lifetimes, a lot of learning, a lot of experiences, a long, long way. A great education in order to now be here at the Kundalini threshold. So congratulations, really, all of you hearing this. Nicely done. Now let's continue. And as we continue into the experience, I want you to really begin to recognize who you are as a person, and who you are as a person responding to strange phenomena. Who are you? Do you flinch at the very, you know, the dropping of a pencil on the floor? I mean, are you really wound up tight? Relax a little more. Relax. Trust your Kundalini. Trust that you even have it. You're even here. You're even listening to this. Trust your Kundalini. Put your faith in the inner divine. Put your faith in the Kundalini that has even brought you to this conversation. Feel the Kundalini in my words. Feel it in the voice. Feel it as it comes into your enlightenment equation. Feel what happens then. Open to what happens then. And yes, that can bring on more phenomena. More phenomena that I don't want you to block. I want you to ride it out. Do those kriyas. Have those tingles. Let the heat come. Let the cold come. Let that gentle breeze in the face occur. Let the chanting and the rose petals falling and the incense and the sacredness, and let the body going out of phase as your arms disappear. Let your body be torn to pieces, just like a rag doll, and have those who are tearing it to pieces come back to you and say, hey, it's okay. We're putting it back together better than new. And feel that surge of energy when you are put together from that dismemberment. And you feel so much cleaner and more focused and strong and active and less debilitated and healed and all of these different levels of experience from a greater flow of Kundalini energy into your system, even from the sound of my voice. And for some of you, especially from the sound of the voice. Give yourself into this process. It's calling you, or you don't even know the word Kundalini. It's not a common word. It's not like tortellini or linguine or any of that. And for those who are still sleeping, beautiful, wonderful sleepers, you know, they hear Kundalini, they're going to associate it with one of the noodles. Yeah. And that's a good thing. That's an innocent thing that carries very little fear charge. So it's a good, it's a protection for them. But for you who have the Kundalini or who know about the Kundalini, who are researching the Kundalini, who are being called into various levels of interaction and response and reaction to the Kundalini, it's present in their mind right now. Right now. It's saying, listen to this. Absorb this. Feel this. Know this. And I want to encourage you to do those exact things. This is a participation activity as well. And a certain level of adopting a certain mindset and a certain level of practice, which goes with the mindset, and from the practice you have the physical, different equilibriums, you know, occurring within the mental, the emotional, the physical, psychological, and spiritual. And from that set of options, certain levels of traveling through grace via experiences are being set up for the person to have. Now, I've said it before, and I'll say it again. One of the greatest and most efficient, strongest, and safest way to come into the Kundalini is through devotion. Devotion to the Kundalini. Devotion to the teacher that is imparting the information. These are the greatest ways of coming into Kundalini, because you're not coming into it alone, and you're not coming into it from a blind reference base that may not agree with your belief system, or may not agree with your culture, or may not agree with the different individualities of the society that you represent and that represents itself through you. Kundalini information doesn't really need to come through religion. It comes through of its own accord. And there are those of you that are listening to this broadcast right now going, yep, that's right. That's right. It came to me. I didn't have to lift a finger to have these experiences. What the hell's going on? Kundalini awakening is what's going on, my friends. This whole conversation is about that. But it can also be about you and your specific experience. So if you want to call in, the number is area code 347-934-0026. 347-934-0026. I would like to welcome everybody who's listening on a computer, a telephone. I see Eileen is here. So hello, Eileen. Welcome. Rosemary, hello and welcome. Josephine Smith, that pioneer person. Hello and welcome. Hello and welcome everybody who is on the chat room as well as we continue. So you have the Kundalini. You're searching for the Kundalini. You're looking for the Kundalini. But you're not accessing the other half of the equation. You're missing 50% of this equation. Kundalini is also looking for you. And it's found you. And it's the one that is causing you to research and understand and find a way into the beginning expression of the enlightenment equation within you through the Kundalini Awakening. Kundalini Awakening must occur. So you're going to get it. And it's a beautiful, wonderful, happy, joyful, blissful experience. It can also be terrifying and crazy and a terrible experience if you allow your fear to contaminate your expression of Kundalini. Kundalini is really known as a great amplifier, a great amplifier of many different energies at the same time. So, for instance, emotional expressions are also emotional frequencies. So the emotion of love has a certain frequency. The emotion of jealousy has another frequency. The emotion of joy has one frequency. The emotion of, say, a meditative state, which would be kind of like absent of emotion but is generative, you know, that will have a certain way. All of these things will be amplified by the Kundalini itself, amplified and transfigured, changed and applied to your personal situation. Doesn't care what belief system you have. It will use whatever belief system you have that it feels will get the point across, will get the teachings across. So if you're a Christian, it'll come to you through Christianity. If you're a Buddhist, through Buddhism, a Islamist, through Islam, you know, a Hindu, through Hinduism, Aboriginal, through Aboriginal belief systems, such as shamanism. It'll come to you through some crazy bearded guy out of Northern California. I mean, it seems to be fairly flexible in its approach. It seems a bit flexible there. So for those of you that have been listening to these conversations, and for those of you that sleep with these conversations going, which I totally recommend that you do, you turn whatever player, computer, whatever it is you got that you can get these conversations in, and you play them softly while you sleep. Not so much that you can hear it audibly, but just enough so that the brain can follow it. And what this will do is this will begin to flavor your dreams towards Kundalini teachings. This is what I did this a lot in my early experience. I seriously recommend for those of you who are listening now on the chat room, but also for those of you who are listening in the archives in the future, I'm really going to push for this show to be shared. So everybody, Julie Fashji, Lauren White, Mike Strong, Suka, please try to share this conversation if you would take that moment of your time. I think that this one kind of needed to come out. Okay. So as you entertain greater and greater levels of energy, I know, Mike, you have an injury, okay? And so you're thinking, well, okay, I have this injury here, and I want to get it better, and so I want more energy into that area so that it can heal itself faster than it normally would. And I just want to take people out of the idea that more energy, like, you know, more gasoline or more electricity, isn't really how the Kundalini is going to respond. It's not your natural gas or your diesel or your gasoline or your steam or your nuclear power. It's divinity. Divinity doesn't necessarily classify itself as a natural resource to be used by humanity. But it's patient. What I want to clue you into is that even though it is patient, it is hopeful that you will also begin to understand your position within the enlightenment equation. What are you doing here? What's going on? What brought you to this point? You, out of all these millions of people who are, you know, following some belief system or other, or lost, you know, atheists, don't want it, you know, they don't want to hear about it, don't tell them, you know, don't, you know. Where are you? You who have tried so many different religions, only to find that each one falls short of the truth that you know is there. that you know through your experiences with the Kundalini is real. You know it's real because you're experiencing it. Nothing like firsthand experience. But for those of you who are investigating or actually being called by the Kundalini, you also may begin to experience some light phenomena, maybe some blockage at the base of the spine, which translates into lower spinal pressure, also known as pain. But you know, not from any kind of an obvious injury, not through a concussion or a contusion or a fracture or a disc problem or, you know, a lower lumbar issue. It's not about that at all. It's just all of a sudden it's there, comes and goes, comes and goes, comes and goes. Same with wild temperature experiences where you're severely cold, nothing can heat you up, or you're severely hot, nothing can cool you down. Go to Kundalini Awakening Systems 1.com and look on the menu item there that says symptoms, and look at the many, many different symptoms that are just a scratch on the glacier of what is available within the Kundalini context. Don't get in the way of your phenomena. I don't care if it's uncomfortable. To some degree, I do care, but for the most part, you're here, you're doing this, you're answering the call. Nobody said it was going to be effortless. Nobody said it was going to be pain-free. Just as we have to go through the teething process when we're children, when we're infants, when we're 2 years old, so do we have a similar teething process within the Kundalini. So you're not going to get away from that. Don't go out to the beach and cover yourself in sand. Although, actually, I have to tell you, that is a very good therapy, especially if you have a lot of gold in the sand. Very nice to have the sun come through the different crystals that comprise the sand and the radiation. But anyway, that's a different topic. You are now here to have the Kundalini. So open to it. Don't block it. Don't try to control your experience with this. You'll be sadly disappointed. Let me say that again. Do not try to control your experience with the Kundalini. Let the Kundalini control you. Let it control you. You surrender to the divine holy presence within yourself. Not to some book. Not to some statue. Not to some meteorite. Not to some structure. Not to another person, unless your Kundalini directs you to. Am I clear? I'm trying not to be ambiguous. I see Lauren is typing away here. Prana not the same as, oh, we have a whole different conversation going here. I see, huh. Prana not the same as Kundalini, that's true. That's true. Manifestation of Kundalini as I understand it is something. Okay. Oh, prana is a manifestation of life force. Life force. Prana and chi are more similar than prana and Kundalini. Kundalini is more of a consciousness, a divine presence. The energy that emanates from a divine presence is what provides us with certain levels of teaching and understanding and bliss. Just thought I'd throw that in there. If anybody would like to call in, the number is area code 347-934-0026. 347-934-0026. I would like to bring Her Holiness Rosemary Goliath on. Rosemary, I'm giving you the countdown, girl. Here it comes. 3, 2, 1.
Hello.
Hey.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you? Good evening.
I'm touched by your words. I am.
Well.
My struggle isn't so. I don't see it as that right now. It just with I think our refinement processes, and so it's not. If there's a churning in me wanting something better than this old self.
Well, you are actually already there. I mean, I can't tell you how many changes I have just occurred and I've just experienced with you since we started working together. Your
yes,
levels of energy
yes.
have increased. Your it seems to have an anti-aging effect with you.
That's helpful.
Well, it is. But it does seem to have that. The energy speaks louder than the flesh.
Yes.
Okay, the energy speaks louder than the flesh because it is what is animating the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Now, please, my dear, would you make any announcements that you feel are appropriate to make?
Yes. I was thinking as you were speaking about Kundalini calling us, and I'm thinking there are people in our city here and in the states nearby.
And what is that city and what are those states?
The city of Twin Cities of St. Paul, Minneapolis, where we are having a Kundalini Awakening seminar with you, Chrism, in September 27th and 28th. And right now, Eileen and I are putting things ongoingly together.
No. You stay away from that Chrism guy. He'll give you information that is very, very, very powerful and very, very strong and might just heal you of some of the mistaken assumptions that we make in our lifetime that may be initiated by larger authoritarian groups of people, such as, you know, governments and whatnot. Watch out for that Chrism guy.
Yes, I am. I'm a close follower of his. I'm a devoted student.
Ah, poor thing. You know what a difficult teacher he can be.
Well, that works two ways.
It does indeed.
Please,
make your announcements, my dear.
So, yes, Eileen and I are, we talk almost every day just in where we are, what we're working on, and expanding it. But I am getting around to places in the cities and a little beyond the Twin Cities with the film, the Kundalini film. Chrism, thank you for that. And I also created a meetup group, and we have 11 members. And
what's the name of the meetup group?
Twin Cities Kundalini Awakening.
Good,
and there
good.
Are a couple
so everybody,
others.
Everybody yeah. in the Midwest, Twin Cities Kundalini Awakening meetup group with Rosemary Goliath. When and where?
Mm-hmm. Well, the next meeting is tomorrow at Lake Harriet Spiritual Community in Minneapolis. And at 7 to 9.
I love the immediacy of our show, don't you?
Yes. Yeah, of our life. It's reflective of our life. It is immediate.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very
but
nice.
I want to tell you this. One of the members, couple weeks ago, just introduced himself, and he was happy to know somebody in the Twin Cities, that there are people in the Twin Cities that have experienced that are awakened.
Okay.
And I've talked with him.
Pause. I'm being reminded by my Kundalini that there are people listening to this who are sleeping right now. They're sleeping. They're entering stages of slumber. And I want you, and I want everybody who's listening in the archives, but also everybody that's listening now in the chat room and on the telephone, the computer, think of these words: Om Namah Shivaya. Namah Shivaya. Namah Shivaya. Deeply, my friends, sleep deeply. Let your Kundalini guide your dreams this night. Let your Kundalini guide your dreams this night. And now continue, Rosemary.
Well, I was saying about the gentleman who has a Kundalini awakening, and he and I talked, and he has a copy of the movie, and he's seen it a couple times, so he was going to look through it again, and then we were going to talk tonight, so I haven't heard from him. I invited him to come, and that he would have, and he said, I can tell people that Kundalini is for real, and it would have something, be something to add to the evening, but we'll see. I don't know right now.
Well, you know, the big caveat with people going around saying Kundalini is for real, what you're really saying is what nobody really wants to acknowledge, that telekinesis is real, telepathy is real, spontaneous healing is real.
Mm-hmm.
All the attributes of Christ and of an awakened person, say within the Hindu tradition, it's real.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the high phenomena are real, and they go beyond the controlling requirements of science. You know, science has the scientific method, so so it wants everything driven through the scientific method in order to reach a consensus upon its reality. Well, this is not necessarily the best way to go about it. It's the way that's been given to us, and you know, Rosemary, you're a hard sciences teacher, right? For how many years?
Oh. 10 maybe.
What did you teach?
I taught chemistry, biology, and math. High school.
You are so smart.
Not anymore. Couldn't do it anymore.
Well, that's why you're doing this. You're teaching something else that requires more than just smartness. So do you hear what I'm saying, Rosemary?
Yes.
Okay. So everybody, everybody in the Twin Cities area of Minnesota, and in the Midwest in general, in Canada, on the East Coast of the United States, on the West Coast of the United States, in the southern sunny areas of Arizona, New Mexico, Nevada, Texas, Florida, Louisiana, Alabama, y'all come on up here. And you come and you
and
visit.
My email address is rosemaryg@usinternet.com.
There you go, rosemaryg@usinternet.com. Thank you, my dear. Thank you very much. Okay, so there you have it. There you have it. Now I'm going to bring Eileen on. Hello, Eileen.
Hello, Chrism.
And do you have any announcements you'd like to make this beautiful day in Florida, I hope, for your sake?
Oh, it is beautiful. I'm sitting here feeling a balmy breeze while I'm listening to you. And it's so easy to feel close to the divine up from the 11th floor looking at the clouds, feeling as if I'm part of that. It's gorgeous.
You are.
I know, it's just gorgeous. But thank you very much for this show. I'm enjoying it. And I really like your mantra.
Om Namaha Shivaya Om. Yeah. Well, that's not mine. That's a Sanskrit.
Well, I know, but listening to you say it, it's really, really nice.
That I can understand. Yeah, I can understand that. Well, my dear, I want to thank you for your organizing with the seminars. So thank you very much. Is there anything you'd like to add to what Rosemary announced?
Well, I didn't hear her announce the dates. It's the end of September, Saturday and Sunday, September 27th and 28th, 9 to 5. And it's actually in Eagan, Minnesota. And you can contact Rosemary, and we're beginning to send out information. So I'm looking forward to being with you again, Chrism, and meeting new Kundalini people and old Kundalini people.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Eileen, and thank you for all the help and everything that you've done organizing this. And I really do want you to, you know, understand in a positive, real-time way that you are indeed part of that heavenly field, part of that divine interaction with the information that you're putting out into areas that have very little information about the actual Kundalini awakening. This is the divine work, or some people would say this is God's work that you're doing. It is the work of God that you are doing, because you are saving people from going into a furnace.
And I'm very grateful that I have this opportunity to help whoever, wherever. And I'm very grateful for your teachings. That's, for me, that's what makes it possible to have a foundation.
Well, that's the Kundalini. That's the Kundalini. You got to be grateful to the Kundalini for that.
I realize that, but it's coming through you. It's teachings coming through you. So thank you.
Well, you're welcome, my dear. You're very, very welcome. And I want to thank you for all the work that you've done throughout the years, far before this current seminar that's being planned, but through the many cross-country journeys you and I have taken together, Eileen. It's always a pleasure.
Thank you, Chrism.
And bringing Her Holiness, the Queen of Questionable Comforts, that would be the Celtic Queen of Questionable Comforts.
Yes.
What has been your experience in resisting the phenomena, Amelia?
Oh, what a little question. Well, the interesting thing was when you were talking earlier, Chrism, I'm one of those people who knew, I did not know the word Kundalini. I had never heard it when the Kundalini awakening happened to me, when I had that awakening event. And one of the things I was blessed with was a couple of weeks of bliss and devotion to what I knew was, you know, a divine mystical experience that I was having. And so for quite a while, there was no resistance at all. It was just complete openness and surrender to what was happening. And then what happened was that feeling left me, you know. I wasn't aware of that anymore, and I was left with a lot of physical things that were very uncomfortable and very fearful. And so that began a new process for me in having to surrender and come to an understanding of what was happening to my physical body in a tactile way.
Yeah, just want to interject here. It's very good points and very good experiential teachings that you're bringing up. But I do want to focus on this this one part that you're saying right now, is that, you know, you initially you'll get these huge sunbursts of joy and bliss and energy and happiness and connectedness and at-oneness and God consciousness and just an amazing level of interaction with divine and mundane realities, and then poof, it's gone. And the lack of such extreme experiences and such extreme emotional states and energies can cause a collapse of any kind of emotional foundation that the person may have come into it with, because the amount and the intensity of bliss can be so strong that its absence after its experience can lead one into depression. Just an FYI. Please continue, Amin.
Thank you, Chrism, because that explains perfectly. And then I came into information through you and through Kundalini Awakening Systems, through the, at the time it was just the Yahoo group, which was like 2009. And through the information and reading, it was amazing for me, Chrism, because it gave an understanding that I didn't have, you know. And so I began to, and then phenomena began again for me. And I found it easier to surrender knowing what was occurring. I suppose in a way it was, I'm looking for the word, there's a word when you know something and somebody affirms it for you. It's like, it escapes me now. But it made a huge difference. And so within the context of surrendering and not resisting, for me, a lot of it was about the information that I received. Does that make sense? And so that's why I think...
Yeah, it does. You know, the level of information that you have is a very powerful thing within the equation. Information can modulate fear.
Yes.
If you're able to modulate fear or control your fear, even as you experience that fear, there is a much greater level of learning that is received rather than terror that is being received. So you go from terror to an actual educational process. It takes the sting out of it.
It does. And it also means, as this is happening, that you know that you're not insane. You know that what is happening to you is normal within a Kundalini context. And that's like a platform to surrender. For me anyway, it was, you know. It allowed me to completely abandon and let go of my resistance. And one of the things as well, I mean, a big thing for me, a key, I mean, seeing as I use that word, I made a post about it or a comment about it earlier, is devotion has been a key that unlocks the heart of resistance, any resistances that I had, you know. It's a key that unlocks that, and it's a form of surrender and gratitude and love to the divine Kundalini within. And it can be done spontaneously. It happens spontaneously anyway, in the sense of, you know, I would have moved through various phases. So I would have moved into a phase where just looking at the grass sent me into bliss, or I would feel devotional for the beauty all around me. And then other times when that fades out, I would have found a devotional practice, one where I was specifically doing a practice of devotion and maintained that surrender and gratitude and joy and the whole thing, the inner and the outer coming together and working in union in my day.
How do you manifest balance in your day as you do the devotion?
How do I manifest balance as I do the devotion? Well, you see, yeah, that's like the devotion of itself is balance. It's like a polarization of balance, and it's like oh, Chrism, I can't find the words for it, actually, but it is of itself a balance. So
I think what you said was right. I think that the action of devotion in itself is balance.
It is in my day-to-day mundane living. And then when I am, and I mean, my devotion becomes part, and we were speaking, I think, on Facebook as well about meditation and how meditation isn't something you've got to sit down and close your eyes and, you know, be quiet. You can do meditation in lots of different ways. You can do it in every activity. It can be a walking meditation, a waking meditation, in what you enjoy doing. It can be, you know, meditation. Well, devotion for me is like that too. And devotion to the Kundalini becomes part of my everyday life.
How do you insert it into, like, say, the hours of your day? What do you do?
Oh, Chrism, when I am, I would consciously...
No, here's the thing, Amelia. What you're doing right now, through talking about this, is you're helping other people figure out how to organize it. A lot of people have an organizational block that, well, I don't know how to put that together. So when they hear how you have put it together, it gives them, I think, a greater flexibility to custom craft one for themselves.
Okay. Well, there would be different ways that I would do it. I would have a time during my day where I do a Chitaka practice, and that is a devotional practice. I also have a mantra that is devotional that I say at particular times during my day. When I am doing something like, if I am doing something, even like eating, there are times, not absolutely everything, but there are times when that becomes a devotional act for me. When I see colors, when I do something, a kindness, I mean, a kindness that I do throughout my day, or a selfless service, or whatever word you would put in it, to me that has been devotional as well. I would ask myself throughout the day, you know, and this has come from you, Chrism, as well, in some of the teachings you have given me. This isn't all from me. This is because I am also devotional to my teacher, because the Kundalini has, you know...
Let's talk about that a little bit now. What kind of a benefit, if anything, is being devotional to your teacher? What does that bring a person?
I do find it difficult, but what it brings for me is a freedom and a surrender and a connection that is inner and outer at the same time. It's it assists me. I know. Excuse me if I am.
It's good. It's good because it is how it is. You know, that's how it is.
Yeah, it is, and it's also, there are times when, I mean, earlier on there were times when, you know, you're not always in the mood, you know. And so by actually committing to a devotional practice and to what you would have instructed me, you know, and suggested that I would do, that of itself was extremely beneficial. It becomes a bridge. It becomes a platform. It is the key that allows me to expand, to have that union and communication with my Kundalini that my ego would try and block. And so because I've been doing this for a while, I'm not saying that isn't relevant anymore, but it doesn't, it is, of course, but it doesn't have the same teachings that it had at the very beginning for me. Now the devotion just flows spontaneously and in my practice all day.
What effect does your devotion have on the people you work with?
it has a huge effect in the work that I do as a massage therapist and the healing that it brings, because when I go into my work, I take time, and I before it would take a longer time for me to do this. It happens much more quickly now. It's instantaneous. I become devotional to the Kundalini, and the Kundalini then becomes very, very present in the work that I do, and I'm just doing what I'm doing, but it's the Kundalini that's doing a chrism. It's very beautiful. It has affected people that have received from the Kundalini in very different ways. And sometimes a lot of the people I see are, they need healing. I mean, a lot of people have illnesses, but they receive healing in ways that isn't always about, you know, physical cure. It's about healings that have really affected them. You know, people cry. People have expressed that they have felt extraordinary things occur during
the
sessions.
I want to bring you back to one session where you saw the lights, and I want you to tell our audience exactly what occurred and exactly what you experienced. Go ahead.
Chrism. If it's okay, I cannot recall that now.
You can't recall that?
I can't.
I can.
I know.
Right after a person, she was massaging, got up from a table, there were many, many, many lights that appeared. They were yellow lights, and there were some bright pink lights. And these lights floated around, and take care of that. These lights floated around and basically made themselves aware to her. Made themselves, kind of introduced themselves in a way. And you know, Amelia, she practices a form of Kundalini healing. It's allowing the Kundalini to focus itself through you for the betterment of another person. And this was one of the communications that she experienced as she was giving a healing. So I'm going to put her back on here. Hello.
Oh, Chrism, it wasn't that I couldn't. It's just I could feel the bliss coming at the thought of it, and that happens. So I had the words.
No, that's good. It's good to have bliss. Good to have bliss. This is good. Brings more energy into the body. So, yeah. So you heard what I said, right?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So, yeah, many, many, many different levels of phenomena can be experienced. And I'm talking visual phenomena. I'm talking tactile phenomena. I'm talking phenomena that you don't necessarily want to have. I know you have to feed the kids. I know you have to get them off to school. I know you have to do what it is you do at the house, to do what it is you do to live your life at this time.
But Chrism, sorry for interrupting, but having a devotional practice that you do throughout your day allows that to happen too, because it anchors you. You know it's coming. When you're very, very busy, you know that you're going to be giving this time for your Kundalini later in the day. And the Kundalini knows that. And there's there's a connection that flows between me and the Kundalini around that, connected into the devotion and knowing that it's going to occur in a particular time throughout my day, which has been hugely beneficial, because you know I can get very, very strong phenomena, and there are times when you know I want to be away doing other things, but because of the devotion, it has allowed that, it has allowed me to do, you know, to have some jobs that I've done. It has allowed me to be with the children, go to school, all of that.
Let's look at the mechanics of your devotional practice. Exactly what is it that you do?
Oh.
Well, okay, all right, I'll spare you that.
Thank you.
What I'm going to suggest a person does is the first thing they'll need to do are the five Tibetans. The first thing they need to do are the five Tibetans, and you can go to my video channel on YouTube, which is Chrism Kundalini. You go there. You know, you look up, you know, the different videos that you would feel that pertain to devotion. And so you do the five Tibetans, and you do a little bit of a practice afterward, which includes some pranayama and some meditation and another level of pranayama and then some more meditation. And then there are certain safeties that I want the person to understand about. I want the person to understand about caffeine and not to ingest caffeine, not to ingest alcohol, not to do a lot of the drugs, not to give in to the emotions of exalted ego-centric expression that can sometimes come with the Kundalini. With some students, I have them on a private type of practice, like Amelia. She's on a private student practice. I do take private students. And if you're interested in becoming a private student of Chrism, you should talk with Amelia so she can really warn you away.
That's Suntara, Amelia, just in case people are confused.
Suntara.
He means me.
Just to warn. Just to give you the choice between the red pill and the blue pill.
Actually, Chrism, in case I forget, I wanted to ask you this because I know Rosemary and Josephine came later. You had already began the program, and that Radiant Sutra is so beautiful and so it just sent me into bliss. And I would ask if you'd read it again before the end of the show.
I'll do it right now.
Okay.
Everybody, all around you, in every moment, all around you, in every moment, the world is offering a feast for your senses. Songs are playing, tasty food is on the table, fragrances are in the air, colors fill the eyes with light. You, who long for union, attend this banquet with loving focus. The outer and inner worlds open to each other. Oneness of vision, oneness of heart. Right here, in the midst of it all, mount that elation. Ascend with it. Become identical with the ecstatic essence embracing both worlds. Wherever, whenever you feel carried away, rejoicing in every breath, there is your meditation hall. And that is from the Radiant Sutras. Bring Amelia back on here. There she is. You're red, Amelia. You're a red girl.
Oh, I'm red. That means I'm live on air. People are wondering what the red and the blue are. Blue means I'm muted and I can cry and not be heard. Red means I can be heard.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, this information I've been giving you today, this is information that you won't hear from most ascended teachers or great wealthy gurus or, you know, some guy who's tired of his janitor job down the street wants to be a Kundalini teacher. Okay, there's very little referral for you to go on that is of a a quality referral when it comes to the Kundalini, which is good. It's good because it forces you to discern, forces you to follow that inner calling within you, the Kundalini calling you onto this path, calling you to the word itself. I had one student, never heard of the Kundalini, wound up in the hospital, I think, from an accident or something, and had a dream where he saw himself in the mirror with Kundalini stenciled across his forehead. Pretty obvious, huh? And he had his friend go look it up. What is that? Okay, and so the Kundalini is reaching out to you. For those of you that are hearing this broadcast, for those of you that are receiving the Kundalini that is being carried by this voice, the Kundalini is calling you. It's talking to you right now as you listen to this broadcast. And, you know, I'm not the only one who knows about the Kundalini or anything like that. I am one that knows about it through my experience with it and evidently through many years of teaching have ascertained that that which comes through me has beneficial effect upon that which is experienced by others. You don't have to listen to me, though. Listen to someone else. Listen to some Hindu guy that's talking about the Bhagavad Gita. The Bhagavad Gita is a great book. Go listen to your if you're in Broadway, New York, go down to Broadway and listen to some of those corner side preachers standing up on a shoebox or whatever it is they're standing up on and teaching the masses as they stream across the street. Remember that, Suntara?
I do indeed, yeah.
Listen to those guys. Listen to them. Listen to your dreams and what the Kundalini is telling you in your dreams. Suntara and I had an experience where she dreamed of seeing me on a bridge in Central Park in New York City. You know, she actually had a dream of it. She wrote it down. She did the memory thing, the whole bit. In her journal right now, and lo and behold, neither of us who'd ever been to that area of Central Park in our lives were able to walk straight to that bridge. We even have pictures of it. Listen to your Kundalini. If it tells you, as it's told Suntara, to be devotional to a flesh teacher, then get on your knees and be devotional to that flesh teacher. There is a reason why you're being called in that direction. It is not accidental. It is not accidental. There's a reason why you're hearing the voice and you're receiving the Kundalini that is upon the voice. There's a reason why you're even here. Listen to yourself. Listen to your equation. Talk with your Kundalini. Have that conversation with your Kundalini. Let it guide you. If it has guided you to these conversations, then it is guiding you to the conversations of information that come through me. Listen to me. Listen to the voice. Take the information while it's there for you to have. Take the information while it is there for you to have. Utilize it in your process. Utilize it in how you meet the day inside of your Kundalini Awakened Enlightenment equation. Take your time. Take your time with this. Get to know this force. As I was saying before, no caffeine, no alcohol. If it wants you to eat meat, then only eat meat. If it wants you to eat veggies, then only eat veggies or fruits. Whatever the Kundalini tells you to do, you do it. forget about all these little petty ego games about, oh, I'm a vegetarian. Oh, I'm a vegan. Oh, I'm a carnivore. You know, who cares? Follow what your Kundalini tells you to eat, period. End of discussion. End of debate. Follow what the Kundalini tells you to do, and then do it. And do it until it tells you to stop. Yes.
There's something as well about new kinds of feelings. It's like how the Kundalini communicates. It's beyond the five senses. It's, you know, our experience expands, and it's like the feelings have extra qualities than they had before. And so these feelings are often a direct communication from the Kundalini. They're not like the feelings that I used to have before. There should be another word for them, but I can't think of it, but feelings.
Well, when you blend with radiance, your feelings take on a radiance too. And that radiance is often what people are experiencing is low levels of bliss. Low levels of bliss and some high levels of ecstasy. But those are pretty obvious. For people like you, Suntara, you're going out, you're giving massages and KITT, Kundalini-infused therapeutic touch, to cancer patients. And you're making a difference in people's lives. This is what feeds your equation. Forget about the technique. If you don't practice the technique, you're not going anywhere. You have to get out and do what Suntara is doing. Get out and move. Get out there and apply yourself in the populations, into the masses of humanity around you. Do that service. That is also a devotion.
As Steve is doing, actually, he left us know he's normally here with us in the chat room, and he's doing service today, so, and being devotional, and we'll be listening to us in the archive. So hi, Steve.
Hi, Steve. Nice going. Keep going, my friend. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Walk the talk, people, because Kundalini is going to walk the talk in you. This path isn't just about you walking it, because this path will walk you. It'll walk you right up the mountain, and you can either come kicking or screaming, or you can come and join in the journey. Join in the journey. Realize that as these phenomena come, as I've been talking about here and there throughout this conversation, as these phenomena come, they're going to change the way you view your reality. You need to expand your view of reality. It's not all about five senses anymore. And for those of you who have the Kundalini, you know exactly what I'm saying. You know exactly what I'm saying. And you know what the true reality really is. And you know, because you know it through your experience of it. Kundalini brings that experience. For those of you that would like to call in, the number is 347-934-0026. 347-934-0026. I think I feel like I want to talk to Utah right now. Let me go to the Mormon Capital Center here, going into the blue. Calling Utah, calling Josephine Smith. Is she there? Can Josephine play?
Hello. No.
Hi, Josephine. How are you?
I'm fine.
How are things in Mormon world?
They are fine. I am managing well.
Good. I just wanted to say hello to you because I saw you were there listening on the phone. And what a blessing you are right now as you give your service to your daughter and son-in-law. I would like everybody to extend prayers of grace and healing to the names that Josephine Smith are going to provide to us right now. Go ahead, Josephine.
Rob. And Becca and Isabel.
Last name? No. Hold that. Rob and Becca and Isabel, receive our blessings of healing. Receive our blessings of truth. Receive our blessings of knowledge and information that may help guide you through the difficulties that might lie ahead.
Thank you.
There you are, Josephine Smith.
Okay.
All right, my dear. I'll put you back on hold. There we go. And if anybody else would like to share the mic with me, the number is 347-934-0026. So if you're taking the Shakti Pant from me, open yourself completely to all of the phenomena. Follow the safeties to the letter. Add grounding to it. Go out and hug a tree or sit next to a tree or eat a little more meat in your diet or have more sex in your experience. Really, really ground yourself by doing the body maintenance type of activities or working in the dirt in a garden or doing hard physical exercise. Don't try to do anything that takes away the phenomenon. You've been called, for those of you who have the phenomena. You are also called, those of you who are searching information about the phenomena. You don't get accidental information about the Kundalini. Like I said before, to most people, it's a noodle. Or very close to a noodle. Okay, another noodle on the menu. For those of us who have experienced the Kundalini, we know how strong it can be, how amazing it can be, how devastating to the current reality it can be, how absolutely joyful, blissful, happy, and ecstatic it can be. And some of us also know how terrifying it can be. It's strong energy. Strong information, folks. Don't block it. Don't stand in the way. Don't take a Shakti pot and then decide, oh, gosh, maybe I'm not interested. Because it's the Kundalini that will decide if it will stay with you. It won't be Chrism. It's the Kundalini that decides that. So I want you to know where you can get some more information about this. Go to the Facebook groups. We have Kundalini Awakening ! Kundalini Awakening Systems 2. We have Kundalini Healing on Facebook as well. On Yahoo, we have Kundalini Healing at Yahoo Groups and Kundalini Awakening Systems 1 at Yahoo Groups as well. You can get this information at the website, KundaliniAwakeningSystems1.com, and you can also get this information on my home page, which is Chris Mitchell on Facebook. You can read a lot of this information there, as well as the YouTube video, which is Chrism Kundalini there in YouTube land. Open to how your Kundalini wants to interact with you. Don't be afraid. It's going to be different. I guarantee you that. It'll have some things that may disturb you, some animals or creatures that may disturb you, spiders, snakes, tigers, whatever. I had a student just the other night, with a spider looking at her that's all black with a silver white stripe going all the way around. With the sky in its eyes. Okay? Kundalini comes to us in certain creatures. Embrace that. Be okay with that. Be all right. Remember, Kundalini is of the natural world, and so of course it will express itself through the forms and symbols of the natural environment, such as the creatures that live there, such as wolves or killer whales or horses or bears or big cats, eagles, praying mantises, spiders, you name it. Okay. Kundalini comes to us in the full range of colors and hues that the natural environment have to give us. Kundalini comes in these ways. I want you to open to your Kundalini through the aspect of the voice right now. Listen to the voice and let your Kundalini resonate with the information that's coming through this voice. Feel the voice reach into your spinal cord through your ears, through the eardrum, through the tympanic membrane as it transfers its levels of sound into the processing areas of the brain, which extend it into the spinal cord itself, which bring it to all the chakras in the body. Feel the Kundalini on the voice. Feel the presence within you. There is no protection that you need with Kundalini. There is no secret handshake or, you know, power prayer that says, wow, you got to protect me from Kundalini because, wow, I don't know, I might get it. You know, if you know about it, if you're listening to this information, you're getting it. There's no protection on this world that will stop this from occurring to you. If the Kundalini wants you to have it, well, you're going to have it. Bottom line. Give yourself into its grace is the better response. You can question its presence as much as you need to, but don't interfere with its agenda with you. That would be a mistake. Open to its truth, open to the learning, open to the education, open to the love, open to the contentment, open to the serenity, open to the exaltation of the Kundalini enhanced enlightenment equation. Open to the holy of holies within you. You are that holy grail, and your Kundalini is the holy wine that is being transported by that holy grail. That is the sans grail. That is the royal blood. The Kundalini is the royal blood. The blood itself is a consciousness. The Kundalini is that consciousness. And this is what many of you listening have happening to you right now. And you're wondering, well, how the heck do I fit this into my daily living? How does this help me get the kids ready for school? How does this help me pay the rent? If I'm in a total desperate situation, I'm in the Icelandic hard lands of pre-Siberia, and I don't have any money, and I have two kids, and winter's coming, and I have 2 months to find the answer. And what the heck do I do? How do I support myself? How do I help myself in this situation? And you go straight to your Kundalini. You prostrate yourself to your Kundalini, which you should be doing every day anyway, but never mind that. You give yourself to the Kundalini and you open yourself to its answer within you. And no matter how your ego hates to hear whatever that answer is, you follow the guidance that the Kundalini has given you. You never know what the connections are it's fabricating in order for you to survive and find your truth and help others find their truth. With Kundalini awakening, it's really not so much a level of, you can't just dip and skip with the Kundalini. You don't get to have a little bit and then, okay, make your choice. Well, to some degree you can. You can read about other people's experiences and, you know, do that type of thing. But really look into what is happening to you. Educate yourself. And for those of you that have it, surrender to it. Surrender to it. Let it open its doors to you. Don't be frightened by the heaviness of the phenomena at times. The phenomena can get fairly heavy. The kriyas, the entities, you know, the entity interaction itself can be really kind of mind-blowing. Once again, as I've stated in other programs, you know, ignore the entities. I don't care if they look good or they look bad or they look sexy or they look whatever. I don't care if they're your mom. Not really. They're just posing as your mother. You stay to the middle of the road. You stay to the middle of the river. Don't you interact with those temptations that are being offered to you. And entities are really good for offering you temptations. You know, they'll go right to your ego. So, hey, God, that looks like a good candy bar there in the window, doesn't it? Oh, my God. It's like, well, you know, you do need extra sugar, you know, in your diet because it tastes good. That's why. These entities will come at you every angle they can just in order to corrupt you and to slow down your process, which if you need your process slowed down, well, then there you go. There you have it. It's a good manifestation. If you don't need your process slowed down, gosh, I hope I'm still there. Am I still coming through?
Yes, you are, Chrism, loud and clear.
Weird.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Chrism? Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, boy, I tell you, you press one little button the wrong way on this studio control board and you're up a creek. You're up a creek. I thought I may have done that. Embrace this. Embrace this change. Realize that you're going to have the phenomena. Some of it will be scary, like the entity stuff. You know, it happens to about 60-65% of the people. Basically, it's a mechanism for people to not think that their five body is everything that it is. It's also, it kind of has the same mechanism as the out of body experience and the lucid dreaming. These are refinement opportunities for people to realize that they're far more than their physical bodies. They're far more than the five senses. They're far more than anything and everything we have ever experienced. And so, you know, it begins to open the person to the understanding that there is something different that is out there that they are beginning to experience. And so, yeah, the out-of-body and the dream work is very, very important, as is some of the other areas. So if you have a question that you'd like to call in, 347-934-0026. And we will take your call. I would like you to listen to this for a moment. Question, Amelia Suntara? Hello. Let me just go right over here.
Oh, Chrism, I have my eyes closed and I was listening to you. Okay.
Hello.
That's all right. It's just Foster.
Hey, Foster, how are you?
Okay. I was hoping that you would invite me to give a call in because I was enjoying the program so much.
Well, thank you for calling in. Thank you for stepping up to the plate, so to speak.
Oh, as long as you're pitching, I'll stand up.
I'm pitching, and I'm a wild pitcher, too, I got to tell you.
Yes, I know. I wear body armor when I come in front of you.
That's right. Put a helmet on. How are
with
you, Frosty?
I'm well. I'm well, and I suspect this will not be one of the times in which I will be lost for words, but please go on. You were about to ask me something.
How is your equation?
It is coming along as the Kundalini wills it. How is that?
That is as it should be, my friend. That is as it should be.
I wanted to just call in and express my gratitude to everyone that, including you, of course, Master Chrism, who has come on. And I know that a lot of times when we are asked, you know, how we go about certain aspects of our practice, it's very difficult because we stand in front of people who are unknown to us, and some who are known, and I'm not quite sure which one is the most difficult, but I can say that I have especially enjoyed this talk. I don't know that you have said anything that you have said before that is different, but
there's more energy coming through tonight because I'm doing the Shakti Pot tonight again, and because so the energy is really strong in me right now anyway.
Yes.
So it's coming through.
Okay. Well, I just want to know that all of you who are participating, I look at your pictures on a daily basis, and I send love to you, and I applaud and honor all of you who are receiving this blessed gift from our teacher and master. I wanted to just touch on something that you mentioned earlier, and Master C, and you mentioned friendship between the individual and the Kundalini within. I generally call this the gesture of friendship. How devotion ties into this is so very, very important. And I appreciate all that you have said on this. And I just wanted to say that, yes, I can concur with all that you've said. This is an intelligent force, this Kundalini. It touches the most sacred and the most secret of places within us and ask if it might be permitted. And all I can say to this is, or by all means, open the door and let it in. Because it can do nothing but improve all that we are as beings or human beings, and it cannot do anything other than that because it is a part of, or it is an expression of divinity, and this divinity is always attempting to be closer and closer with each and every one of us. And I thank you for these talks, these satsangs, as I prefer to call them, because they are meetings in which we discuss spiritual topics. I can't explain to you how grateful I am to you and Suntara Eileen, Rosemary, and I'm sure I have a list over here that I can probably pull up that will touch on everyone that listens to these talks religiously as I try to, because it is the divine coming through your voice, Master. That is actually doing the work. Not necessarily the words, but the words are really good. I like your delivery, and I like your sense of humor. But I just wanted to say to all of those who may come on and listen to this, that block, if you can, out all expectations, all needs to express what you have heretofore felt to be truth, and just listen with an open heart to what you are bringing forth at a particular moment. It's not easy. Believe me, I've been placed in a position where I've had to give talks after being notified 10 minutes in advance before hundreds of people, and I know that it's not easy, but how you do it without effort is amazing to me, and I am devoted to you. As my teacher,
I'm devoted to giving that to you as your teacher.
And I appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you, Festi, for calling in. Thank you, Festi. For our sleepers now, let's remember we have people that are sleeping to this conversation. Now, a little prayer I'm going to seed into your consciousness now. I know you're hearing this. I know that you're comprehending this. And I know that you can receive this little prayer for you. So here it comes. Gana untuam ganapati avamahe, kavin kavinum upamashavastamam, jay shterajam brahmina brahminam, aspata anaha, nasem vanu tbc de saranam. And with that, I would like to bring Her Holiness, the Celtic Queen of Questionable Comforts. Thank you, Amelia, for another conversation. It's always a pleasure being with you and with Eileen and Rosemary and Josephine and Basti and Mike Strong and everybody who is listening.
And I with everybody as well. Thank you very much, Chrism. And we have 54 seconds left. So goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye, everyone. Goodbye. I'm going to end this with a few ohms. This broadcast. May it forever serve you in any way you may need it.